you so much for giving your time for listening to this webinar. So I'll be on the first. I just want to insert a thought in each of your mind, saying that is the C++ language is still alive in this industry. At the end of this webinar, the take home will be what is the importance of C++ in the day-to-day life. That's what I want to instill this thought in the beginning, and the answer. I'll just share whatever the knowledge that I have, and at the end you will be able to conclude the answers from yourself. So to begin with, I'll start with the overview. What is the overview of this presentation that I'm going to present? So we will have a brief overview of the C++, its history, its pros and cons. What are the pros and cons that are there in the C++ language? I just give a basic definition of what a class that are there in the, because C++ is an object-oriented model, and the basic unit of the object-oriented model is a class. So we will have what a class is. Then we will go into some of the basic data structures, not deep dive into what are those, the initial data structures that are important in any language. And we will have a basic demo of how a class is written in C++ with its syntax. And we'll try to do a debug of those. Like, apart from writing a code, we should know how to debug. So a little demo on that it will be given. And what are the applications that has been developed using this C++ language? And what are the trends and job opportunities that are there in the recent industries? So with that, we will go forward. C++ is a language that is developed years back by a person named James Troutstrup. He was a PhD student at the time, and we have only language that was a C, the basic C language, that has been created. So after C has been created, he was a PhD student and he was creating this particular as a project. So that's why I want to keep his code. If you keep your good ideas to yourself, they are useless. You could just as well have been doing crossword puzzles. Only by articulating your ideas and making them accessible through writings and talks, they became a contribution. So this is an idea which made him to create a language that still, which he started as a PhD project, and it's still available in the industry, and it's ruling the industry for around 30 years. So as a student, we are all student of the life. So I request everyone to, if you have some ideas, give life to it, and it will be useful for many more years. With that, I'll start my course with this presentation. So let's first start with the history of C++. So in 1979, it started as a C with a classes, which is a basic unit. And from then onwards, the class and references. C is mainly with the pointers, and he some more implementations and features added its capability. The original C++ edition that came in 1998, the C++ it got commercial and it got released. And the next major release, O3 is in 2003, we have O3, which is about optimization that are there in the compilers. And in 2003 and 2009, majorly it was related to the compilers optimization that we got. In C++ 11, we got a quite number of features that came after the initial release. It made people to use friendly. It made C++ as a higher level language. And further on from C++ 11, we have C++ 14. And C++ 17 is the one which came with the lesson. And C++ 20 is under development. It will be, it is almost in the final stage. It will be released this year. So each one has its own features and easy to use for the developers. So first, what is the important? There are so many things are there. Why it is important and why people are still talking about this language. There are many languages that are there, hundreds of languages, but only few languages that are there ruling the industry even till today. And this is the something which started with the initial stage of computing and still relevant even today. So that's the reason we will see why it is ruling this world. So why C++? So these are few points that I have blurred. For each of those, I will be explaining you. Portability. What does mean by portability? So I can write a code in any of the operating system. I can write it in the Windows. In Linux also we have multiple OS that are there. Like we have Ubuntu, we have OpenSUSE, and others like Unix based OSs, as for example Mac OS. We have different OS that are there. In whichever OS we write the code, it will be able to execute. The only thing is we have a compiler of that particular OS which makes us compatibility. So it doesn't restrict in whichever hardware. We don't need to worry about any hardware or the software that we write the code on it. So most important thing is portability. And object-oriented. What is important in object-oriented? We are able to relate it with the real-world objects that are there. So suppose I wanted to create an object like a student. I want to create an object which is like a bill book. Or I want to create a object like a webinar session. I can relate it to, it's not just respect to a pointer or some language which is unknown to. We are able to associate with the real world objects. That's why it got more importance in the initial times and also in the recent times. The low level manipulation where it helps us, it is pretty close to the machine language. It's a like it's abbreviated from C. So C is very close to the machine, and C++, it is still closer. It has the control of all the units that are there. For example, memory units, so we will be covering it, like memory management and even the kernel. So in OS, there is something called a kernel. It will be able to access those kernel objects. So it has the control over the machine more than other languages. And memory management, we can have total control, like how many memory we need to allocate and how many memory that we need, we take care of those. So it improves our speed and improves our we can optimize to the level that we want. And there are some certain libraries that also they have given, like in C++, we have the standard template library. So for example, with the compatibility with C, we can have, if you know the C language, you can still write it as a C++ and we can compile with the C++ with the extension of C++ and still it will be able to run. That is the importance of the C++. And for scalability, whether it is a small scale of data and large scale of data, the program itself will take care of it. Even if they have a computation intensive applications that are there, we can scale it with respect to the code. There's no need to change any code with respect to the data. And since this is a language that is existing for 30 years or more, and people have larger communities that are there to support if you have any issues, there are Stack Overflows and other portals, they are ready to help what are the problems that are there. So with this basic understanding of why C++, we will move on to see few of the disadvantages that is there because of which we got a little bit deep in this or concerns in this language. It has use of pointers. It's a concept that is not easy to grasp. It has, and if we not able to use the pointers properly, we can crash our applications, for example. So we have a knife. If we have a knife, we should use the knife properly. If you don't know to use the knife properly, it can hurt our hand. So pointers is such, and if it is very useful, but yeah, if you're not using it properly, it can hurt the application. So that is the where the other languages, they removed this pointers, they abstracted this pointers and they have different way of addressing it. In C++, since we are dealing with a low level application, we have the pointers which helps in the control of all the low level hardware that we can access as of now. And we have certain security issues mainly because of the pointers, and we have a global variables. Even though we have a protection that is there, but still we can violate those security. Absence of garbage collector. For example, there's languages like Java and higher level languages or the Python they have, and garbage collector, for example, if we can we can allocate so many memory that we require, and at the end we may forget to remove any of those memory at end of the application. So it may cause a problem for C++ because It all lies in the hands of the developer to take care of removing all those garbage collectors so that the application runs without the memory starvation. And the last is the absence of built-in threats. So we have a separate library called POSIX, for example, where we have the libraries we use for threading applications. We have the support, but it is not seen supported as a built-in libraries that are there part of C++. But in the recent C++ 14, these applications, these libraries are being included. Some of the in Boost, also one of the library which was there not as part of the separate libraries has been included in C++ 14. And the reason for C++ has all the capabilities, that's why it's getting so popular in the recent times. So let's go to the fundamental unit, which is makes a different from C, for example, is the class. So let's see the syntax of the class. So on my left-hand side, so I'll just take a pointer. So we have the class. We are saying that this is a keyword which is known as class, and we give our class name. These are the access specifiers. The term is known as access specifiers. It will show that whether it can be accessed outside or it can be accessed inside. What are the security levels that we want to keep it? So with parallel, I will be comparing with these two. So here is the class, and we have the class keyword. For the class name, I'm creating a student class, for example, if I say. This access specifier is nothing but I'm keeping it as in public. So it can be accessed publicly from the outside the classes. So that's why it's as a public. These are the members. Member one, member two are nothing but name is a variable of type string. So this is one member. And ID is one more member. So we can have access specifier for each of the members. For example, here I have given access specifier for public for both of these members. And there is something called member function. So these are print name and print ID are known as the member functions. For example, in the print name, here the implementation of the function is not given here. It will be given outside. This is an inline function where we give the implementation. For here, this is represented as a comment. So the body of the function. So for here, we are just printing out in C++, yes, we are just printing out the student ID. And we close this with a semicolon. So this is the structure of the class. And there are multiple concepts that are also there. Like operator overloading, multiple inheritance, encapsulation, polymorphism, all being supported by C++. Let's go deep. We'll just give an overview of it, and you can learn it from the other sources. So let's give an overview of data structures. What are the data structures? Why the data structures are there? So now in the previous slide, we saw what are the classes, and the members are nothing but the data. So how the data can be grouped that is together? Makes important. For example, we are having a person who is standing in the queue. We have something called a queue data structure to maintain with the real world. And if there is a cards that if you play the cards, it is in the stack. So we can represent with this data structure. For example, if you are in a Uber and there are so many, you are in the share and there are connecting different objects. So we use the graph and we have some dependency in finishing certain work after a course. Only after finishing this course I can take up this course. So we have a tree structure. Like there are different possible structures which we can relate to the real world. So in that we have all this in the form of a standard template libraries that has been provided by the C++. So the data structures it's nothing but the grouping of the data. It's data and its structures. How we group this data together. So there can be two. One is the linear and one more is the non-linear. Linear is in a single, it's like a single 1D dimension. It's one dimension you can view it. So array is nothing but a single dimension. Array is how we can measure like a group of chunk of data that is one after other. Like memory address. The memory address are one after another. If you take a memory, it's like an array of data that's being grouped. Stack also, it's if you see, if everything is like a group of one after the other data that has been in a single dimension, either coordinates or y coordinates, but only it perform a different operation. So here in array, everything it has to be continuous, like one after another. There should not be any gap in between. That is importance of array. Even for the stack and queue, it is also a continuous. There's no gap in between, but the operations are different. In stack, what is coming in? Whatever we keep on top, we take it out. It's known as last in, first out. Like the last person to come in, but the first person to get out. So for example, in our playing cards, if you see the cards that we pile up, the first one will be there, whatever is in the top. So even if you keep a card on top of that pile, you will take that whatever that you are kept in last in. Right? And queue we have seen in our day-to-day life in so many places, wherever we want to purchase or something, or in a shopping cart, we stand in a queue. Like whoever goes in first, they'll be able to leave out of the cart in the first. So this is a first in, first out. This is the stack is nothing but last in, first out. So linked list is also a continuous get data, but it not be sequential. Like the so here what we doing is it can be connected with respect to the address. So suppose I am at this location, there will be one more person for the next data can be in some other place, but we can give the address of that the next place so that it gets connected via the list. It's a link, such a way it's called as a linked list. So it is a list which is continuous, but it is linked with respect to the address. So here is the one we use of the pointers, where it becomes little tricky when you access a linked list. But there are C++ provides a standard template library where all this has been abstracted out internally. In the outside, we can just access it without using the pointers. And for the nonlinear, we have graphs and we have trees. So graphs, it can be a connected graph or it can be non-connected graph. So it can be closed or unclosed. So there's multiple paths that are there. In tree, it's not a closed, it's always open. There are multiple branches and there'll be always a root node, we call it a tree, and there'll be a single root that is there, and there'll be multiple leaves, we call it at the end. That's why we call it a tree, where the tree will have a single root and there are multiple branches and leaves. So whichever that that comes, we use these data structures. So with this, I'll move in how, when we code something in C++, how it internally works. So let's go. We have a source code. For example, we write all those classes and we have created a source code. And we have a compiler. So it is with respect to each of those language, we have separate compilers for its own flow. So it converts that higher level language, which we understand, to a machine language. So it creates something called an object file. So it will just create it with whatever the name that we go with an extension .o. From here, it'll get converted again to an assembly and it will run in the further. So before that, what happens is we won't give everything that we can write it from the application. So we reuse certain libraries. We use certain that is being given by the C++ libraries, or we itself can create some libraries which we use them in our applications. So that we are called as a library files, which is linked using how we have compiler, which is one using the linker. This links the object files and library files. We will create something for executable file, which will be created, which we will run for running our applications. Before continuing, we'll just go to a demo. Sidetrack, if you have any questions, you can just give your chats to Ashwini. I'll take the end of the session. So here, whatever the class that we have taken, the familiar one, we have created a class and these are the access specifier and these are the members and we have the member functions. And this is the function print home, which is not one that is implemented inside the class, but we have implemented using, this is a student class and we have implemented using here. And this is our main function. It just creates an object student. And these are the member variables. We are just hard coding it as the name. We are not getting from the user. And we are printing the name altogether, like print name and print ID. So here this is a website. We can do it in the online and we have created it. So it gives me what the student name is, Skylink, and student ID is 2020. So before this, I just thought that I should say how you can debug an application. So I just show you how it runs internally. So here, what is the, this is our code, and we have not implemented what is the cout test, and this is the IO stream, which is also like we take it from the header files, which is linked by the linker. So only this has been done by us. All other things has been done internally by the compiler that creates an application. So suppose I want to debug this application. So I just start the application. So you could see that it's highlighted here, the student. If you could see that I have not initialized anything for the name and ID. So in general, whatever the value that is there in this memory, it will be taken. It will be uninitialized, some garbage value that is there. Luckily for us, the name is empty string. It can also be a garbage. So it is important that initially we should have something that is being assigned. So whenever we are giving a variable, we have to assign. That's important. So next is, it was here. Then we're going to the class student. It is trying to create an object with respect to it. Now we are assigning, so if you could see, it's not yet assigned. So student name, we have assigned it as a skill link. So it changed as a string link. If you could see that in student, the name is changed as a string link. And again, in the next one, it is from the junk value, it has given with 2020. Now we go with, we wanted to just print name of it. So these are the breakpoints that I'm just keeping. So we call this print name, so automatically it comes here. It prints the name of the student name as it prints here. So we are done with the printing name of it. So if you see, this is the next is the print ID. We call this function. So it's print ID, it's calling in this function, and this is the executed. So it's just a sequence of steps that has been executed one by one internally. So I just wanted to, so if you have any problem, you can just use this. Apart from coding also important, the debug is also equally important. So I just wanted you guys to know how it can be done, how it done internally. So once we print these two values, then we exit the application. So let's go back to our application. So with this, we'll see what are the applications of C++. So for GUI, it is creating it. C++, it is pretty, it's not, there are applications with C++, but it's not that famous. With the UI, there are many other applications that we use, but the games that are there, and which involves mathematical simulations, for example, if it involves a few of the games which has each of the pixel, it has to change, where it involves a lot of graphics or animations, or if we have much of interface which changes periodically based on the actions of the gamers, everything is being designed with C++. You can see, you can just Google out of your Unity C++. It's of more popular in the recent time. And most of the operating systems that has been created are using the C++. If you have Windows, Apple, Mac OS X, Symbian OS, all the Unix OS has been developed into with respect to the C++. For the web applications, if you see the Internet Explorer, the Chrome, Firefox, Safari, Opera, all is being generated using the C++. It's because mainly because of the high speed you're able to, and you can access the hardware also, so you can load the memory, they can control. All these helps in creating these applications. These are the applications that has been created by C++. And there are many web applications that has been created mainly because of the all the web browsers have been created because of the high speed and able to access the low memory. And we have the DBMS, all the relational DBMS, relational databases, where we have the standard row table wise storing the data. For example, Oracle, MySQL, IBM, RDMS, all has been done using the C++, mainly because it helps in the file handling. It has the reliability, and we can relate it using the class, objects, all the functions, all in together. And one more thing, when we related to the, DBMS, and apart from the object-oriented, I just want to say in the English language, we have A, I, O, U as the vowels. For the C++ also, we have A, I, OP. So instead of U, it's P. So abstraction, encapsulation, inheritance, and polymorphism. O for object, which is nothing but the object, and P for polymorphism. Yeah, this is when I just thought it's like how we have for the vowels, and this is important for C++. And we have the libraries. There are a few libraries in the machine learning they still use, for example, TensorFlow. If you have guys can Google it for the TensorFlow, it has been developed entirely by the C++. Even though machine language uses Python as the interface for the developers, but all the engines that are running behind are done by the C++ language. And for cloud computing and distributing and distributed applications, it is mainly used because it supports the load tolerance, and if you have multiple machines that are there connected together, and how we interact, and it helps in the scalability for all those things. We have a low level language, even though it gives the functionality of a higher level language, but still it can interact with the hardware. That's why it belongs to a middle level language rather than a low level language. So these are the applications of the C++. And let's go into the trends that are there in the industry. In the newspaper, this is being taken from the industry. So Indian coders still in love with C++, while the rest of the world is embracing the new programming language. It just came the business in India around July of 2015. So I'll just say that why people started moving away from C++ during that time. And if you see of now, in the September 11th by the Hindu, C++ is now the fast growing programming language, the report says. Even one more I in the C is also growing because of all the IoT devices and the applications that are being created as of now, where we have relatively embedded programming, which is nothing but can be done with using the C language. And since C++ is a superset of C, if you have a knowledge in C++, it will be helpful in knowing all other languages. So for finding out why there's a dip, just associated with this, TOV is a website with a community which takes care of finding out which is a language that's updated trend in the recent years. So if you could see from 2000, so black is for the Java, and blue is for the C, and orange is for the C++ and Python, and this is for the PHP. So Python is the one for this particular green, which has been relatively in the recent years, it has gone up from 2000. So for the C++ is the one we have in the orange. We have this initial dip that was there around 2014 to 2015 that was there, and still it is in the market as well. And in the recent years, we can see a dip in the Java, but C relatively has grown in the recent years because of all the IoT that has been applications that have been developed. And C++ it has own applications that is still relevant than any other language. So we'll see what are the job opportunities that are there for the C++ developers. So whichever software that is being related and in C++ related, there are so many finance company that has been using the C++ because of all this level of security that is required and the scalability, where we have so much of competition that required all use C++. We have the Android application development engines. We have, for example, which I said about the Unity, C++ also uses. And for the game development, when you have multiple mathematical simulations that are there that has to be done for the graphics, we use the C++. And for virtual reality, we use C++. If you go into a telecom domain where we speak with different 2G, 3G, 4G, now the 5G has come recently in Hyderabad. And so all these telecom devices where the applications speak with the hardware, they all use C++. In the semiconductor industry, where we have the chips has been manufactured, which we want to know whether the chip is fine or not, or when we have to design a chip, everything we use, the basic language which is closer to the hardware is C++. And for the creating of some antivirus, if you see a Norton or McAfee, Symantec, all these people use from C++. So these are the domains they use widely in C++. So where you can be a software developer, C++ developer, where you C++ is nothing but application or gaming developer, and a system engineer where you who in like more kind of an embedded engineer, or you most of the compilers also is written using the C++. Like maybe other compilers, other language compilers, but the compiler itself will be written in the C++. And even for the game developer, I already covered about that. And what are some of the companies that they use? Is the Google, Amazon, the top companies, Intel, Microsoft, IBM. They still, since I mentioned all the OSs and all the web browsers, most application has been developed using the C++. So that's the main reason that these are the companies still, they take people who has the C++ language altogether.